Hey, welcome out to Charlotte Church. We're so blessed to have you. I'm Pastor Josh and my wife Anna, and we're just blessed that you're here, and we know that God's got something for you, and so that's what we're excited. So if you're new, stick around, ask questions, don't just run away. We want you to, you know, talk, have community, and that's what today's all about. For you guys that have been at our church for a really long time, we're so excited about today. We haven't really shared about today what it is, because some of you are like, hold on, are we still in a message series? What's going on? So this is a unique service, as always, to Trailhead, but this is definitely unique, being that today we're actually going to talk about the vision of Trailhead Church, and we're going to celebrate in our annual report of 2018. So we're going to share with you all that took place in 2018, the things that are going to come and what we're going to do and some of the systems and processes and all that good stuff. So that's what we're going to talk about today. You picked a great Sunday to find out more about Trailhead Church. One of the things about us is that we like to say is that we're very transparent. We are not a church with closed doors and little hidden pockets, and there's no conspiracy theory of Denver airport. Some of you are like, what's that? I'll Google it. It's good times. It's a rabbit trail of crazy. But what I'm trying to say is that we're a church that wants to be completely transparent in all that we do. And we want to tell you the why to what we're doing. And we want to get you involved. That's what the body of believers is all about, okay? And all of you are alive here this morning, right? Everybody's breathing. So that means there's no dead bodies in this room. Meaning that as the body of Christ, we're here for one another. All right, we're here to serve, and so this is important. So Trailhead Church, what is Trailhead Church? Who are we at Trailhead Church? Well, we have this unique slogan that we say often, and that's finding a better way. We want to find a better way. You know, every year when I'm getting my sermons ready and all the different pastors and staff as we're preparing for sermons, we're asking ourselves the questions of what does a Christian look like? Right? So we're trying to make sure that you look like a Christian, meaning you're getting fed in every area. And some of the areas, there's five different areas that we try to focus on as a church. And the first area that we focus on is worship. Now, we may not be able on a Sunday to talk about all five, but throughout the year, we are hitting on all five. And so one of those is worship. We want you to understand what it is to worship. You know, worship's important. As I mentioned last week, worship is when we are worshiping our Father in heaven in his presence of who he is, that deity. And so we are worshiping him. And so we want to have a full capacity worshiper, meaning that you don't have to have Stephen and Josh and the rest of the crew in your pocket. You can't have them in your pocket. Wouldn't it be awesome to have Eli drumming behind you and everywhere you go? I'd love it. I'd just love to have Eli around me 24/7 anyway. But you can't have these guys in your pocket. So that means that you got to learn how to be a worshiper. A worshiper is not just music. It's worshiping God's presence, knowing a sense of knowing God's in the room. Got to worship, right? So that's what's so important. Now, another thing is that we try to focus on is fellowship. Fellowship is perfect. And a meaning like it's perfect in the sense of fellowship, meaning that you're getting along and that you are in one mind and one accord. And we offer many opportunities to be in fellowship with one another, whether it be through our men's and women's Bible studies, or our Trail God groups, or even in our interest groups that we have. But we want you to be in fellowship with one another, asking each other to go out to eat. And, you know, one of the things that is so important, that we want friends and that you can share and love one another. So that leads me to the next area that we try to focus on, and that's discipleship. You know, with discipleship, this is where we're sharpening one another and we're being there for one another, looking at the Word of God for our circumstances. A few weeks ago, Jeremy Harkins, he calls me up and said, hey, let's have dinner. I've got to ask you some questions. And I was like, yeah, let's do it. So he and I, we went out to eat and we talked about parenting. And he was asking me about parenting. Before you know it, I was asking him about parenting because some of the things that he was doing, I was like, dude, I love this. This is a great idea. And then before you know it, I think it was about a week later, he sent me this great curriculum that he found on Right Now Media and said, man, this would be really good for your kids. And I was like, thanks, man. Discipleship. You know, we put fellowship, I did right here this morning, I put fellowship before discipleship because you need to be in right standing with one another. If there's not any type of division and there's no like any type of strife or anything, it's fellowship that you know one another and that you can be there for one another with no type of hidden agendas or anything. And so that was so great that Jeremy and I got to share with one another our hearts and our desires to be better dads. And that's important. So with discipleship at our church, we we want to promote this. That this is something that's encouraged, that you have the ability to look at the Word of God and ask someone, say, hey, I don't understand what this is, or hey, I have a circumstance. Do you know something in the Scriptures for me to follow or to look at? And it's great. Discipleship's so important. It's obviously a very large key ingredient to being a Christian is discipleship. The next area of the four out of the five is ministry. So ministry is also very important. Now in ministry, I'm as the pastor of this church, I'm here to help and equip you and to guide, but I'm not one that if you come up to me and you say, what area of ministry should I be in? That's not for me to tell you. That's for you and your relationship with God, that God will instruct you and he will encourage you. And before you know it, that's where the desires of the heart. God knows who you are and there's desires. Now as me, I want to cultivate those desires. All right, and all the pastors on staff, all of us want to cultivate that desire in your heart so that it manifests, so that you come out and you go, oh, I know what this is. God's been speaking to me. Some of you guys are super artsy and some of you aren't super artsy. Some of you are super brainy. Some of you know how to do structure, and all that is needed in all areas of ministry. But God's uniquely designed you. Some of you, you have a call in your life to be a missionary and you don't even know it. But something's leading you to that calling, and that's where you got to learn to cultivate it and allow God to speak through you. So it's really, really important that ministry is focused in on in your life. It's an everyday occurrence. It's not something that just on Sundays, or it's not just something for certain people. It's all of us. All of us have a calling in our life, and we need to cultivate that. The next area that we talk about in our church is evangelism. Evangelism is so important. Guys, we have goals in our church, and one of those goals is 1,000 salvations. Well, I want you guys to realize something. The 1,000 salvations, we want to hear your numbers. They don't start and finish right here on a Sunday morning. You know, the church, yes, we consider this to be a church as far as the building, but that doesn't define who we are. Our church is outside of this building. You're the church. So when you're out on the streets evangelizing, that's a salvation moment where you have an opportunity to share the gospel with someone else and lead them to Christ. We want to hear your numbers. Call us, email us, and let us know. One of my favorite days ever being a pastor was about a year or so ago, and Sarah comes running in, bringing her friend in from lunchtime and said, hey, I just witnessed to her. Let's lead her. Let's pray down the road of salvation. Let's do this. And we were like, all of us were in the youth center. She comes in and just drags her friend in, and we were like, yes, let's do this. Yeah, we were cleaning. Yeah, we were cleaning the church, and here comes Sarah just dragging her friends in from lunch break, leading them to Christ. Because you can't find any better time than that, you know? But evangelism happens everywhere, and that's where if I'm not saying that these are in order as far as worship and fellowship and discipleship and ministry and evangelism, but what I am saying is that there's a sense of steps that you've inhabited Him, His presence, the God's presence, that everywhere you are in that worship, and knowing that you're in right standing with Him, that you're able to evangelize everywhere you are because people will sense the presence of God in your life. That when you're in the shopping line, when you're at the restaurant, when you're just hanging out the ball field at your kids' games and sports, everywhere you are, if you have welcomed God in that circumstance, in that environment, people will know that there's something different and they're going to ask you about it. And it's not something so many people look at it as a chore. You look at it as a chore because you haven't recognized how good God is in your life, or the presence is just, He wants to be around you. When He wants to be around you and you realize that, it doesn't become a chore to ask somebody. It doesn't become awkward or weird. They come to you. They start asking you questions of like, hey, and then they say the normal thing. I don't know why I just told you all that. And that's where you've got to be ready and equipped as a disciple of Christ that you go, oh, I know why. Because God's goodness is bigger than any circumstance you have. And God's wanting me to share with you this goodness. So let me tell you about God's goodness. And that's how it works. And so that's what we want to focus on here at our church. You know, we, as I said, we want everyone to encounter the presence of God. That's our direction and goal. Everywhere you go, we want you to have an encounter with Him. We want you to be in right standing with Him. You know, we want people to understand their full potential by discovering this through spiritual growth opportunities, because we believe in the creator of all things. If being that we believe in the creator of all things, God, then don't you think that it's best that we go to him for all things? So in all things of our life, a full surrender of our life over to him so that we can be all that he's intended us to be. So that's a big key thing. Now, we are casting vision here this morning. And in casting vision, I look back at in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, of great men and women who were a part of casting vision. And you know what they did? Before they cast vision, they were really adamant about being in right standing with God. And with that, you know, the last 2 months, if you've been paying attention to the message of Jesus, we talked about Jesus in January, and in February, we talked about being face to face with Jesus. You know, that for me, I was preparing us. I've had a few people, a couple guys, they were really funny. They were like, man, your sermon this morning, goodness gracious, it hurt. You pricked me. And I was like, well, I didn't mean to do it like that. Like, I got to go back and start talking to God about some areas of my life. And I think there's always that's the beauty part about the word, that it aligns you up to what he's intended. So there's going to be some change. If you want to have growth, there's got to be some change. All right. There's some change that's going to take place. And so when I look at the vision that was cast throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, they spoke of the need to get in right standing with God and present themselves as a living sacrifice. So that's what I'm trying to prepare our church for. You know, my intention is to get us that we realize there's more available than what the world has to offer. And so we need to tap into that. And so that's what it's all about. So why are we going? Let me say, before I say this, follow. When Jesus said, follow me, he said, follow me. That there's some action to this follow, right? There's some action. When I tell my children, it's so aggravating in the morning time, I'm trying to get them all dressed and ready. And I go, guys, I'm going out to the truck. Follow me. And I turn around and they're not there. And I'm honking the horn and I'm beeping and I'm screaming, come on, right? Because why? I want them to get in the truck so we can go. And it's really aggravating when they're not doing it. Right? So it shows me they're not following me. Well, the same thing goes with Jesus. Jesus says, come on, get in my truck. I want to take you somewhere. He wants to take you someplace. So you got to get in the truck. He says, follow me. So where are we going? I want you to understand fully my motivation as your pastor behind the why to what we're doing at Trailhead and why we do what we do. Okay? So the motivation is that when we get in this truck, we're going someplace. Why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? Because I've seen broken homes. I've seen broken marriages. I've seen broken people, right? I've seen them restored. That's why we get in the truck with Jesus, because I know he's taking us to a better place. I've seen marriages restored that were so devastating, and there's so much hurt and pain. I've seen God come in and restore that. I've seen students in our youth ministry, I've seen them restored from broken homes. I've seen a change, a generation changed because what Jesus can do, right? I've seen breakthroughs. I haven't seen them because I'm not over there, but I hear the breakthroughs with children, and they have prayer requests to the teachers. And then a few weeks later, there's a praise report from a child. Man, I'll tell you what, that's big, right? So that's why we get in the truck. Because I know where Jesus can take us. And so that's our encouragement that we do this. So I believe full-heartedly that God is a restorer, all right? That's why we do this. So what's it feel like? What's it feel like sometimes in the truck? Well, it isn't easy sometimes. Let me give you a great example. One of my favorite bands, they changed their names now. They're a little different in their band. It was Mute Math. But the name they had prior to this was Earth Suit. I love that name. I think it's just so silly, Earth Suit. But I do look at this as an earth suit because I have a heavenly body coming soon. Soon and very soon. Please. So anyway, earth suit. I look at us like sponges. What we surround ourselves with, we soak up. You know, in the world that we find ourselves in, sometimes we soak some things up that aren't really pretty. And quite frankly, when God starts pouring in, that stuff has to go. And to give you kind of a sickening visual, it oozes out. Sometimes there's a smell, stench. Sometimes it doesn't feel good coming out. But we know what God's putting in is good. And so sometimes it's not easy. Sometimes the people around you want to point out, oh, and they want to kind of knock you down. They want to discourage you and not encourage you. And it's so important that we learn to encourage one another. So sometimes it involves challenge. It involves discipline. And it may lead to some hardship and persecution. But you stay faithful, and I promise you, God's promises will take you out of it. You know, we know that God tells us from glory to glory. So the rewards are infinitely greater than anything this world can offer. Anything. So that's why you got to stay faithful and you got to pursue the things of God. When you do this, sky's the limit. God will continue to get you into a place where you'll see that that design that's in you, those desires will start pouring out. And you'll go, this is better than anything I can ever experience. So how are we going to do it? How are we going to do it? Because I, you know, some of you get, what's my three-step program here? Well, here's how we're going to do it. It's going to take discipline, okay? It's going to take some discipline. And this is what our church is all about. We want to present spiritual growth opportunities to you to help and to guide and to lead. So we've got to learn to by immersing ourselves in the scriptures, consistently walking in the Spirit, asking Him to reveal the transforming glory of Christ to us and obediently following as He leads us, we will see the fruit of the Spirit maturing in our lives. And in seeing this, we'll find ourselves being transformed from one level of glory to another by the Spirit, transformed into the image of Jesus Himself. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, it says, so all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. You know, the question's been asked. They say, you know, can God sin? Well, okay, yeah, God could sin, but it's not in His nature to sin. Now, let me give you a great example. The best example I can give is I have a trash can in my kitchen, and sometimes there's some old food in there, right, from a few days ago. Well, that trash can will sit in front of me, and I could eat it. I could eat out of that trash can, right, that old, nasty, moldy food. That could happen, but I don't want to, right? I see the food. I see what's in there. Could I eat it? Sure. What do I want to? No. And so that's the same thing that's happening with the transforming through the Holy Spirit, that we have the ability to start looking at the things of this world, sin, and start having a desire from the inside out where it comes and it says, I don't want that. I don't want to be a part of that. So the Holy Spirit renews your mind to look at these things of saying, I don't want that. I know what this produces. It produces sickness and disease. It produces ailments that I don't want to live in. I don't want to be a part of that. I want the good things of God. So that's what God's doing. He's bringing us from glory to glory, and you're going to see transformation. Now, what can we do? What can we do while we're in this process? Well, there's all sorts of things we can do. Everybody will need to play a part. Everybody, his or her part in realizing the vision of the church. You know, we have processes here at the church to help you with that, finding your next step. You know, at the end of church, I would encourage you to step outside there and across from where we serve the coffee. We have our next steps area, and Austin and the crew are out there to help you with that process. Maybe it's serving. Maybe it's, you know, volunteering in some capacity through our student ministry, our children's church. We have opportunities that on Thursday, we're setting up the youth center over here for children's church on Sunday. So we're doing cleaning in the morning time. We usually start around 9 a.m. We're cleaning, we're setting up, we're prepping. So you guys, we have co-op classes across the street on Sunday mornings. And the crew over there, they need help setting up some chairs and presenting some snacks and different things for the folks when they come in. They're welcome. And they feel welcomed. And it's an environment where it's transparent and it's nice and free, and that's what it should be. There's opportunities when we set up on Sunday mornings. There's so many different things we can do, but there's ministry opportunities as well. And we want what God's designed in you to come out so that we all can fulfill the Great Commission. And so that's why we welcome those different things. So I would encourage you to find that next step. And maybe some of you are at the next step of just baptism. You want to get baptized. You want to find more information about the Word of God? Well, we've got men's Bible studies. We've got trail guide groups. We have women's Bible studies. We have these opportunities, so we want to do this. We have something in the pipeline right now. I'm probably not allowed to tell you, but I'll do it because it's not being recorded. And we've got this marriage thing that's coming up. Oh, I'm so excited. It's like a marriage discipleship thing. We're working through this thing. I'm just going to tell you that, but it's going to be huge and big, and we're really excited about this stuff. So all of these things are happening. You know, we want you to join a trail guide group so you have fellowship, right? We want you to get involved in the interest groups. We want you to serve. You know, the kingdom of God tells us to serve, so let's serve. Another area to get involved in is giving. You know, we talk about being a full surrender. Some folks have a misconception of a full surrender. Full surrender meaning that everything is God's. Everything. And so it's asking yourself, hey, am I doing what God's called me to do in giving? Am I tithing? You know, am I bringing all the tithes and the offerings into the storehouse? Malachi 3:10. Are you doing this? Are you following this process where you say a full surrender? God, what do you have for me to give? It's sacrificing. It's setting yourself in a position where God can move. You know, years ago, I had a friend who he's in ministry, but a church had asked him to come up, and they were going to plant another church, and they asked him if he would be willing to be that pastor in this church. And unfortunately, he had some financial type of restrictions and constrictions, and he looked at the church and he says, I want to so bad, but my finances have bound me up that I can't do this. But he said to me, and he said to a few others, he said, I'll never, ever do this again. I will adjust my finances so that when God says move, I'm ready to move. You know, that comes back to Matthew 6, where Jesus says, hey, you concern yourself with the things of God, he'll take care of everything else. And that's where I want you guys to do this. Even myself, my wife and I, we find ourselves in a financial bind and to start this church. And I looked at her and I said, I don't want to have any type of financial bind over top of us. So he told me to sell my 1966 Volkswagen bus. And it was the hardest thing I've ever done. Some of you guys remember not too long ago, I talked about that and I cried on stage because I missed my bus. It's really sad. That's how bad it was. So with that, we adjusted ourselves so that God could move. And we saw favor. The minute we did that, man, door after door. I remember the real estate agent, we told him, we said, we're selling our house. And they said, you know, the market's not great. And I said, hey, it doesn't matter. God's in control. Because we have put him in control of everything. And guess what? Our house sold immediately. And they even were like, how is this possible? It's not normal. You guys got really lucky. We're like, no, we didn't get lucky. We put God in control of it. When he's in control of it, he can do it. All right, so it's so good, it's so good. So Luke 16:10, whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. That's really important, guys, really important. So what is the reward? So some of you guys think of this tangible prosperity reward. It's not. I'm not talking about prosperity. Again, go back to Matthew 6 and read this, okay? The reward here of being a faithful, diligent servant to God and being fully surrendered to him, you're going to see a life of true fulfillment. You're not going to be aimlessly walking around. That's why we named ourselves Trailhead. We believe you're aimlessly walking around if you're not following God, not having a relationship with him. So when you have that relationship with him, you're on a journey and you can start at the trailhead. And that's why we're doing this. So for me, there's a big difference here. And I want to break this down. The reward. There's a difference between the Spirit residing, okay, meaning in us, which is true of all born again believers, okay, and the Spirit reigning in us, which is true of only some believers. So let me say this again. There's a big difference between the Spirit residing in us and the Spirit reigning in us. The Spirit is ready and willing, okay, of a full surrender, ready and willing and eager to reign in us. But his power, remember what Jesus said? Jesus said that it's better that I depart from you so that the gift, the Holy Spirit, will come on you, right? To what? All men and women. Some people leave that out. Some people are like, only the people in the upper room. Jesus said, for all men and women. So here we go. So that difference is the Holy Spirit is willing and ready. His power, unfortunately, is being blocked until we surrender fully to God. So once we surrender to God and ask the Spirit to fill us, He will begin to change our lives. And that's what you're going to start seeing. So in ways that will amaze and delight you, the Holy Spirit will actively carry forward the process of transforming you through the renewing of your mind. The process works from the inside out. It's not simply the changing of external behaviors, but the changing of their source. So as I said earlier with the trash can illustration, is that you'll look at this and you'll go, why am I been doing this? There's no reward to this. I don't want to be a part of this. This just brings more and more destruction in my life. Why do I keep going back to this poison? But I need to renew my mind and get myself in a place where God can use me. So renewed minds produce renewed thinking, values, attitudes, desires, motives, and behaviors. So our hearts will increasingly appreciate God's grace to us, and our minds will increasingly desire God and His will more than our sin and its pleasure, consequently weakening its hold on us. So as I just casted the vision of hey, it's time to get in right standing with God, this is where you need to right stand yourself and say, God, what do you have for me? What is this? So this is let's move to the past here. Let's go to 2018, our annual report. So Tim, are you up there? The beard. Tim, here we go. Let's go. First slide. Everyone knows we have changed our logo this past fall, and changed our logo with the mountains and the sea. And why do we do this? Well, we recognize a lot of you say, why do you love North Carolina? And you say, well, because you can get to the mountains, you can get to the sea really easily. Well, we've thought that's great. So we want to put in all of our minds that while we're here in North Carolina, okay, that you're going to reach people from the mountains to the sea. That everywhere you travel, you're going to have an opportunity to speak the love of Jesus Christ into people's lives. So that's our goal. So in 2018, our annual report is an opportunity to see how God is moving at Trellis Church. And remember that every number represents a changed life. So go ahead, Tim, next one. So last year, decisions, we had 31 salvations. We had 26 baptisms and 135 prayer of agreement, meaning that they came down praying for a breakthrough or something of the sort. So this is pretty good, right? Now, some of you could look at this and you go, 31 salvations? That's not a lot. Well, let me tell you, 31 people are going to heaven now. Now, do we want to do more than that? Absolutely. And that's why I say that we're focusing in on that worship, the fellowship, the evangelizing, discipleship. We're focusing on these things so that we can better ourselves to get out there and do the call that's placed upon us. And 26 baptisms, that's awesome. All right, next one. We got to go through this. Groups. We launched our groups last year. Keep going. This has been awesome. 24 interest groups, 15 trail guide groups. And within the trail guide groups, we have 205 trail guide members. That's phenomenal. Go ahead, Tim. Next steps. So last year we saw 410 first-time visitors and 81 first-time givers. That's awesome because we know that people are surrendering. They're saying, all right, I want to surrender. I want to start this. And what's it look like? And that's just great. But 410 visitors, guys, that's why it's important that all of us recognize that there are people that are hungry and they're looking for a place called there. So we need to show ourselves friendly. We need to do everything we can to present fellowship when people come to visit. All right. Next one. You see, last year we had in our co-op classes on Sunday morning, we had 12 number of classes offered, and we had 50 people participate in the Pathfinders course. And then out of some of these classes, you see that we had 302 total class attendance. Now, with the 50 Pathfinders, again, the importance, we had 410 visitors last year. Well, guess what? We want to see that number come to raise the following year. And how are we going to do that? Well, again, we're going to show fellowship. We're going to encourage people to keep coming and get involved and start that discipleship process. All right, next one. See, last year, average attendance was 449. And then the kids, 131. So that's quite a bit. That number's stupid big. And I love the fact that we didn't round down to 130. We actually like, no, every kid counts. Yeah. All right, next one. So you see our record attendance, 578 at Easter. That's pretty normal. And then obviously our Journey Home project, which was really awesome. We'll talk about it in just a second. But 522 in attendance there and 514 the week after that. So those are our three highest attendance last year. Go to next one, Tim. See, last year we did like, I think it was 6 events over the summer for our children's programs. We had 580 total over the summer being involved in those programs, which is awesome because that, again, that's showing, this is giving us the numbers we need to see when we're saying, are we a church that understands fellowship, discipleship, evangelism? And these numbers are proving that. And then we saw 30 youth go to youth camp. That's awesome. That's really great. Our youth pastors, Pastor Philip and Kelly, they're doing a phenomenal job. And so we're seeing an average of 20, which is about normal average. But we know that on Wednesday nights, we've seen parents say, this is really a drive. It's kind of out of our way. It's a little inconvenient. I hear that out of them, but not out of the kids. So let's get a little inconvenient. All right, let's bring our kids out and get them a part of this. All right, some of you, it's not very fun. It is fun when you show up. All right, we need you there. So make sure you make opportunity. Plus, that's why we have women's and Bible and men's Bible study every other Wednesday. They coordinate with one another. So be a part of those, okay? Next. So we see events, obviously women reign. So, whoa, men get with it. Men get with it. All right, next one. See, volunteers, 185 active volunteers. Guys, that is awesome. Well done. Next one. Church staff, we have 4 full-time. So who is that full four-time? That's me, Pastor Dave, Pastor Jeremy, and Pastor Christian. So Christian's our children's pastor. Jeremy's our creative pastor. He does all the graphic and web design. They do such a fantastic job, all of them. Pastor Dave is over all the finances and some of the in and out, not some, but a lot of the in and out operations throughout the church. Christian's obviously the smartest one out of all of us. We've all recognized that. She is brilliant. We love her. We have 3 part-time. Who is that? That's Pastor Stephen, our worship pastor. We have Pastor Katie, our connections pastor. And then Pastor Philip, our student youth pastor. So they are phenomenal. And then we have 19 volunteer staff, which is, let me tell you guys, the time they put into this, meaning they have a regular job, and then they put in extra time on top of that to be a part of what we're doing as a church. And they are phenomenal. They are so phenomenal. All right, next one. So see on Facebook, some numbers here. We have 2,187 followers, and this number is really big, 46,000 minutes viewed. This is really big because when I was out at a conference a few weeks ago, people, I would introduce myself, and they knew who I was, kind of, and because I have certain acquaintances, and then they would say, oh, Trailhead Church, I've seen your videos. And so Pastor Jeremy's done a fantastic job in those videos, and so those videos really help. And I'm not talking about like the videos of like highlights of some of our events, but our testimonial videos. People are wanting, we've had requests for people to use our testimony videos at their church. So we're kind of like, sure. But we're like, yeah, here you go. So it's been really cool. Okay, next. Websites, 12,000 website users, 10,000. This is really big for us because we don't promote trailhead.info. So that's a big thing. And then average time, this is really big. Most of the time, and Jeremy, I'm correct on this, it's more like 30 to 45 seconds on most websites as far as average time viewed. So we're seeing an average time of 2 minutes and 16 seconds on our website. So that means the content there is actually really potent and they want to stick around. They want to read more and find out more about our website. So that's really cool. All right, next. So this is just a handful of outreaches, 102 Thanksgiving baskets, 113 first responders served, 115 fed at high school sports dinners, 68 free sports physicals, and 100 plus volunteer hours in the community. It's awesome. Next. Missions. So last year in 2018, we gave 12,383. The year before, we gave a lot more than that. And that was due to the fact we went on a missions trip. Transparent and honest, Dave and I saw that number this year and we're going, we don't want to do that ever again. And 2017, I believe the number was $30,000. Now, last year, we did some adjustments as far as our budget goes because we were doing a lot of demo work at the warehouse in our new location. So a lot of that equated into this, but we don't want that to happen. You know, we want to make the sacrifices to see fit that our missions, our outreach teams are getting all their needs met as well. So that's not a number that this pastor is happy with. I just want you guys to know that. But at the same time, this still, we celebrate every number. So this is still big. And then in all of that, all the missions that we support, Christ for All Nations, Safari Missions, Allied Churches of Alamance County, International Missions Outreach, the Worship Collaborative, and Reach Home Missions. Those are our missionaries, and we're so proud of them and what they're doing. You can go to the next one. So here's our finances. So last year, we saw $586,000 come in. And in that, we saw a net income of $98,000. Clearly, we are sandbagging for our new facility. And so we're doing a lot of different things to equate, to get us into that facility. One of the reasons why we've actually hesitated, usually I do this spiel in 1st of February, but we were hoping to give this new news of, hey guys, we've got the bank loan, and we're all going to celebrate, and everyone's going to go, woo, but we're still in the process of financial institutions of getting us approved for our construction loan. So we didn't want to wait any longer. We're going to have this today, but that's where we are. We're doing all of this. So that's just an average of giving per adult. Obviously, people give more than 35 and it fluctuates. That's just an average that we try to use as a number to help us base ourselves on a couple different scales. On the next thing, you see our expenses, 28% in operations, 33% in facilities, and 39% in staffing. So we are a very healthy church in the sense of what we're doing and what we're putting into. We take care of our staff. We make sure that all insurance is paid for, and we do a couple different benefits as far as the cell phone, different things of that taken care of. If you ask any one of our staff members that have their cell phone paid for, they go, oh, it's completely 100% church. Everything is church, and it's great to see the dedication and the commitment that our staff have towards the things of the church. And so within our operations, you see there's all sorts of different things in the operation. If you are inquisitive about the breakdown of that, you can talk to Pastor Dave. He can help you out with all of that. Next. And you'll see now the Journey Home project that we did this past year as far as a giving campaign to raise funds for this. We put a goal in front of the church at $450,000, and we saw that you guys committed to, go to the next slide, Tim, $524,000 for over 2 years. This is great. This has been a key component into us getting approved for our construction loan, seeing the commitment that the church has to see our new facility come to existence. So it's really a great thing. On average, $4,200. Obviously, again, we have people that have made the commitment that I want to give $10,000 or $20,000 over the course of 2 years, and that's just been phenomenal. All right, next. That's it, right? That's it. All right.